All right, welcome back to the Cloud Church. I'm Robert Breaker, missionary evangelist to Spanish and English speaking people. Last week we went verse by verse through the chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians, and we are continuing our verse by verse Bible study through the epistles of Paul in order of when they were written. And we are in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 this time. And just to remind you, last time we looked at charity, and all of chapter 13 was about charity and how important charity is. Well, this chapter, all of chapter 14, deals with one topic as well. And chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians deals with the topics, a topic of tongues. Now, this is very important. There is a denomination in the world today that believes they have the gift of tongues. And I believe I can speak about them because I used to be a part of that denomination before I was saved. I was in the Assembly of God Church. They called themselves Pentecostals or Charismatics. And they taught me that I had to speak in tongues. And what they told me, even though this isn't the Bible, they told me that I could not have the Spirit of God without speaking in tongues. And so they told me I had to speak in tongues to get the Holy Spirit. Now, why is that wrong? Well, let's look at it. According to the Bible, we've looked at this many times before, Jesus Christ died. Jesus Christ is the end of the law to everyone who believes, Romans 10:4. So the law was over, Jesus Christ came, he died, he redeemed us from the curse of the law. The law was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. After Christ, we're saved by grace. We're not saved by the law, we're not saved by works, we're saved by faith alone. Well, when the church started, God chose Peter and told Peter to go out and preach. And Jesus Christ, a Jew, went to Jews and sent out his apostles that were Jews to Jews. Well, the nation as a whole rejected their Messiah. That's when Peter went to some Gentiles in Acts chapter 10 and 11. Well, eventually God called Paul. And God revealed some things to Paul. And the Bible says the apostle Paul is our apostle according to Romans chapter 11 and verse 13. And we today are under Paul's ministry. Not under Peter's ministry. Not under Jesus' ministry. We are under ministry of Paul and Paul's gospel of 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Now, according to Paul, when do you get the Holy Spirit of God? Is it when you speak in tongues? You see, all this speaking in tongues and getting the Spirit stuff, all these charismatics, they pull it out over here from Acts chapter 2. They don't realize that Acts chapter 2 was written by Jews. It was Jews going to Jews. And the Bible says tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, but them that believe not. And these tongues were assigned to Jews. But we're no longer Jews. Now the gospel is gone to Gentiles. So this miracle of tongues, this gift of tongues, is different than what Paul is talking about today. And as we go through and look at chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians, we will see what it is that a tongue really is. But because this took place in the early book of Acts, and by the way, Acts is a transition book. It's a change from Jews to Gentiles. It's a change from being baptized in water to receive the Holy Spirit to believing by faith and receiving the Holy Spirit the moment you believe. Now, like I said, I was taught in the charismatic movement that you could be saved by trusting Jesus Christ. But even though you got saved, you didn't get the Holy Spirit. That's what they taught me. And they said, now you have to speak in tongues to receive the Holy Spirit. Look at Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. According to Paul, that's a false doctrine, what those Pentecostals taught me. Because according to Paul, the moment you believe this gospel is the very moment you receive the Holy Spirit of God. So in Ephesians 1:13 it says, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. The moment you believe is when you receive the Holy Spirit today under Paul's ministry. So you believe, that's when you receive the Holy Spirit. Back here, they spoke in tongues. And they got the Holy Spirit by water baptism. And it was different. It was Jews for Jews. But we who are saved today, we're not saved by tongues. We don't even have to. You can be saved and never speak in tongues. You don't have to speak in tongues. Tongues is a gift. And Paul said, covet the better gifts. There are a lot better gifts than the gift of tongues. Covet the most earnest gift, he says in 12:31. So what is a tongue? Well, first of all, let's define a tongue according to the Bible. A tongue in the Bible, well, let's leave that up there. A tongue in the Bible is a written, spoken language. Now, with that stated, every Pentecostal charismatic church that I've ever seen or ever been to, and I've been to a lot of them before I was saved, they say that when you read 1 Corinthians 14 and you see the word unknown tongue, they say the unknown tongue means it's unknown to you and it's unknown to others. And they say that an unknown tongue is a tongue that only God knows and nobody else knows what you're saying. So they tell you to raise your hands in the air, and usually they have a really short preaching service. Usually not, it doesn't even go longer than 20, 30 minutes. And then for an hour, they all sit around and go, and they all think they're talking and they're all speaking. And yet, by their own confession from their own mouth, they're saying nothing. And they say, well, God understands me. Why would God want you to talk and not know what you're saying? And why would he want you to do that and then say he understands what you're saying? That doesn't make sense. If you go back to Acts chapter 2, you find out whenever God gave that gift, it was by Jews for Jews. And that gift was preaching about Jesus. So when they were speaking in tongues, they were saying, he's the Messiah, he's the Messiah. And even then, the miracle was the fact that they were heard in their own tongue. Let's go to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting. And it appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So they spake in other languages as the Spirit spoke through them. So they weren't just blah, 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 saying nothing. What they were doing was, when they spoke in another language that other people understood, and they spoke about Jesus. So the modern charismatic movement is sick, because they're telling you speaking in tongues is saying, and you're just saying absolutely nothing. And yet, when you go to 1 Corinthians 14, Paul says it has to be for edifying. Who does that edify? Nobody. So in Acts chapter 2, look at that. Verse 5, and there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because they heard every man them speak in his own language. So, when those apostles were speaking in tongues, others heard them in their own written, spoken language. It was testifying of Jesus Christ. 12 apostles, 12 different languages. And it says it there in verse 7. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? And it mentions those people. So you can find out what the actual literal languages were. Verse 9, Parthians and Medes and Elamites and the dwellers of Mesopotamia and Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, I'm in verse 10, in Egypt and the parts of Libya around Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians, do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. So they were speaking in tongues, the early apostles. They were speaking in a literal spoken language that people there in Jerusalem understood. You go to any Pentecostal charismatic church in the world today. Is that what happens? When those people get up and say, oh, hallelujah, fruit of the loom, are they speaking in another language that someone understands? Are they just blabbering with their mouth? You see, the true miracle was God spoke through the mouth of the apostles, and when he did so, he was preaching about himself in another language. But yet the modern Pentecostal charismatic movement, they don't preach about Jesus. They're told to speak in an unknown tongue. No. It's always a known tongue according to the Bible. So back to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. What does it mean, an unknown tongue? All right, here's what's happening. Paul started a church in Corinth. Now, I hate to put a steeple, but people won't know what a church is without a steeple. So Here's the church of Corinth. All right, this church is full of people. So when Paul says, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, what is he saying? He says, it's a tongue that's unknown to the church. So let's say this guy comes into the church and he speaks Spanish. Everybody else in the church speaks English. So if he comes into that church and starts speaking, guess what? He's supposed to remain silent, according to the Apostle Paul. And he says, but if he speak, let him speak in turn. And then it says, with an interpreter. So someone has to interpret what he says. Now, if another guy comes and he speaks German, guess what? Need an interpreter. And let it be at two or by the most by three. And pray that he may interpret. So all these tongues being spoken in this church in Corinth, it's all to edify the hearers. And all charismatic Pentecostal churches today, they don't edify anyone. They're taught, you need to pray in an unknown tongue. And who are you talking to? Nobody. So with that in mind, let's go to chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians. And as we look at chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians, we find that the entire charismatic Pentecostal movement is a lie. It started with the Azusa Street Revival years ago with a black man preacher that, according to many, couldn't even read, who invited a woman, a crazy woman, to come in. And that woman began to twist the scriptures from the book of Joel and to tell people, oh, that's written to us and we need to pray in tongues and do this. And she completely ignored the rules of speaking in church according to the Bible. And that's what chapter 14 is. It's the rules of speaking in tongues. And that's what we're going to look at today as we go through chapter 14 of 1 Corinthians. And let's ask the question, do these Pentecostal charismatic churches follow these rules that God gave in 1 Corinthians chapter 14? Chapter 14, verse 1, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that ye may prophesy. All right, what is prophecy? He says, but rather that ye may prophesy. What does prophesy mean? Well, when you prophesy, you're preaching. And that's what this is all about. These early apostles that spoke in tongues, they were prophesying to the men that were there that heard in their own spoken language what was being said. And it was edifying to the hearer. Many Pentecostal churches don't edify. So prophecy is saying what the Bible says. It's preaching. And we'll see that in the context. And it says, but rather that you may prophesy. So the most important thing is preaching. And when you preach, the most important thing in preaching is doctrine. And that's something I found in my time in the Pentecostal church that was very lacking, was doctrine. Pentecostals, they don't like to talk about doctrine. They don't spend much time in preaching. They want the service to be over so at the end of the service they can all walk the aisle and stand for hours. And now they're passing out and barking like dogs and clucking like chickens like at the Brownsville Revival. Well, if you've never checked it out, go to YouTube and look up the Kundalini Revival. Because there is a thing taking place today that looks a lot like what they do in places like Brownsville and Toronto. And they say it's the outpouring of the Spirit, but you look in other countries, people are doing the exact same thing that these Pentecostal churches are doing, but they're pagans and they're inviting demons to come into them. The Kundalini Revival. You need to look it up. So when you do this in a Pentecostal church, how do you know you're getting the Holy Spirit? How do you know that you're not getting an unclean spirit? You see, the Bible says, I didn't write it up here, in Ephesians 1:13, that when we're saved, the moment we believe, we receive the Holy Spirit. But yet the Pentecostals say, no, you don't. You get it when you speak in tongues. Uh-uh. They just sinned against the Word of God. So they're expecting to get a spirit by what they're doing. Well, if you study the Kundalini movement, I believe that's what it's called, is Kundalini. I can't spell it. You just have to look it up. When you study that, they believe in repeating a mantra. And as they hands in the air and they stand and they repeat their mantra, they're waiting for a spirit guide to come inside of them. You better be careful. This Holy Spirit movement of Toronto and Brownsville might not be of God. It might be of the devil. You see, I live close to Brownsville, Pensacola, where this so-called revival took place in the 90s. And I've talked to people that went to that revival. And they said, I just sat there and I couldn't move. I just sat there and I felt so wonderful. But I felt a fire burning inside of me. And it hurt, they said. And I said, you think that was God? Oh, yes, I know it was God. And I said, well, the Bible says this, this, and this. And you know what they've told me? At least two or three that I've talked to. They looked at me, and their eyes bulged out, and it scared me. It made me think they had literally a demon. And they said, I don't care what the Bible says. I know what I felt. Whoa, you better watch it when somebody says, I don't care what the Bible says. I want to follow the Scriptures. That's why I'm going through this chapter, verse by verse. And if I see a church or a denomination or a person that's disobeying the rules in this chapter, I do not want to follow them. I want to follow the Bible. So, 14:1, follow after charity, desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy. That's interesting. Follow spiritual gifts. The Pentecostal church was one of the most carnal churches that I've ever been in my life. When I was in my teenage years, I was part of the youth department of the Assembly of God Church. And all these kids would come in on Sunday morning, and they'd all act spiritual, and la 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 la, and do all that. But Saturday night, they were fornicating and drinking. Friday night, they were running around and carousing and doing... And you go to Pentecostal churches, they've been married 3, 4, 5 times. It's very seldom that you find someone in an Assembly of God church that hasn't been married more than 3 or 4 times. So where's the spirituality in that church? It's very, very carnal. Why? Because they're disobeying the rules of the Scripture. So, verse 2, for he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. Now look at what that just said. In an unknown tongue. If a man's speaking in a tongue that's unknown to the church, he speaketh not unto man. But look, it also says that in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. That means the Spirit doesn't understand what he's even saying. So if a guy's speaking in a tongue that nobody understands, what good is it? He's speaking in an unknown tongue that's unknown to the church. Speaketh not unto man, but unto God, for no man understandeth him. How be it in the Spirit, he speaketh mysteries. Now, I talked about when a man speaketh in an unknown tongue. It's like a guest speaker coming and preaching in the church. And what we're going to see later in this chapter is that a woman is not allowed to preach or speak in a church in the context of prophesying or preaching in tongues. And yet, you go to a Pentecostal church, an Assembly of God church, a charismatic church, and there's women preachers, there's women deacons. The women are the main ones in the church going, la 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 la. And they've just disobeyed the Word of God. And you want me to believe that they have the Holy Spirit when they're disobeying the Bible? I can't do it. I've been there, I've done that, I've seen that, and I've read the Bible, and I got out of that because that was not scriptural. So for no man understandeth him. See, it's all about the understanding. When you go to a church, the reason you go to church is all about hearing the preaching of the Word of God. That's what it's all about. It's all about what God has to say. That's why you go to church, to hear the preaching of the Word of God. But most of your modern-day Pentecostals, most of your modern-day charismatics, I like to call them charismaniacs, they go to church just to hear their own voice. Because they're going to church to hear themselves go, la 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 la, and talk. They want to go and speak in tongues, rather than go and hear someone speaking unto them in a language that they can understand so they can be edified from the Scriptures. So it's a great, great deception, the Pentecostal movement. Howbeit in the Spirit he speaketh mysteries. But he that prophesieth, verse 3, speaketh unto men to edification and exhortation and comfort. So prophecy is speaking. A man goes into a church as a guest speaker or as a pastor or as a deacon. He preaches for edification and exhortation and to comfort them. It's all about speaking in a tongue that the people in the church understand. It's not going to a church and speaking in a language that nobody understands. That's what the Bible is talking about. Verse 4, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue, and this is unknown to the church, edifieth himself. Well, that is if he's speaking a written, spoken language. But most Pentecostal churches say, no, when you speak in tongues, you're speaking no language. Only a language that the Spirit understands. I had a guy one time who was a Pentecostal. He said, well, what about that verse that the Holy Spirit maketh intercession with groanings that cannot be uttered? That's what I do when I speak in tongues, he said. And I said, did you just read the verse? It said groanings that cannot be uttered. What are you doing uttering groanings that cannot be uttered? It's like their minds don't work when they read the Bible. So verse 4, and all this started in the 1900s with a crazy woman. I believe she was double married, if I remember. A crazy lady who misapplied the scriptures to herself. She didn't follow Paul like we're supposed to today. And she went way back over here to the book of Joel, something that's talking about is going to happen to the Jewish nation here in the tribulation when they'll see visions in the last days. It was to Jews, and she tried to apply it to Christians and try to say, well, we're supposed to see visions and we're supposed to speak in tongues. Verse 4, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifieth himself, but he that prophesieth edifieth the church. So prophecy, preaching, it's all for edification. Verse 3, unto men to edification. It's all to edify. It's all to teach. You go to the church to learn the Bible and hear someone preach to you to edify you. Not to just go blah, 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 and say nothings in the air to where no one understands. I told you this story before, but I got to throw it out there. In Honduras, when I was a missionary to Honduras, there was a woman that came from America. And we had our church here that we'd started. And up the road, there was a holiness church. And they invited a Pentecostal woman to come to that church and teach all the people in that church to speak in tongues. Well, guess what? They're having their little speak in tongue meeting. And one of the missionaries runs down the road. And I had just left, but the other missionary was there. And they said, help us! Help us! And he said, the missionary said, what's going on? They said, we have a man in the church service and he's screaming vulgarities in perfect English. And he's cursing God. And we're scared because he doesn't know English, but he's speaking in perfect English. So the missionary went up there and he found that they were having their little tongues meeting. And rather than being filled with the Holy Spirit, this poor sucker, this poor young man who only speaks Spanish, got a demon, obviously, because he's cursing God in English. And he's in a trance, and he's going, oh, no, no, I hate God, oh, no, no, and stuff like that, and using dirty, bad words. Now, do you think that's of God? No. Someone's disobeying the rules of God and trying to tell you, oh, but this is of God. No, it doesn't work that way. Verse 5. Paul says, I would that ye all speak with tongues. Paul wishes that they all spake in tongues. What does that mean? He wishes they all spoke in different languages. Did you know the Apostle Paul spoke in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek? At least three different languages that Paul spoke. And he wishes that everybody else was as smart as him. I speak English and Spanish. Probably don't speak Spanish very well. Probably don't speak English very well. But he said, I would you all speak with tongues. And then he says, but rather that ye prophesied. For greater is he that prophesieth than he that speaketh with tongues, except he interpret, that the church may receive edifying. Once again, it's all about edifying. So what is he saying? He says, I wish y'all spake in tongues. I wish there was people that had three or four languages. And if one spoke in the church and there was someone that spoke another language, there'd be an interpreter that can interpret it so that everyone understands. But he says, it's better to prophesy. It's greater he that prophesied than he would speak in tongues. It's all about the edifying of the church. Everyone is there to learn from the Bible, not to walk around and just wave your hands in the air and pass out on the floor and crazy things like that. Verse 6, now, brother, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you except I shall speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine? So the Apostle Paul says in verse 6, what's it going to profit you? If I'm Paul and I come to a church that speaks Greek and I start preaching in Hebrew, what's it going to profit you? Nothing. If no one's there to interpret, I'm just speaking into the air. In fact, he says in another verse, I'm like a barbarian blabbering in the air. Blah, 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 blah. I'm like a trumpet that's an uncertain sound. So once again, he tells us, look, it's all about edifying. It's all about knowledge or prophesying or doctrine. That's the most important thing is doctrine. And the Pentecostal Charismatic Church has their doctrine wrong because they told me I had to speak in tongues to receive the Holy Spirit when the Bible does not teach that. I received the Holy Spirit the moment I believed and trusted the gospel. And I'm sealed with the Holy Spirit of God. I am sealed with that Holy Spirit. Thank God. That means I can't lose it. That's eternal security. Which, by the way, Pentecostals don't believe in eternal security. They believe they can lose it. Verse 7. And even things without life-giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? So he's saying, why listen to something and you don't know what you're listening to? You don't go to church to hear people go, blah, 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 blah. You go to church to get fed the scriptures, the doctrines. Verse 8, for if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle? 9, so likewise, except ye utter by the tongue words easy to be understood, how shall it be known what is spoken? For ye shall speak into the air. And that's what happens in many Pentecostal churches today. They speak in the air. And they told me, I went to a church camp one time, and they said, have you ever spoken in tongues? And I said, no. And about 8 people put their hands on me, and they said, put your hands in the air. And they said, now say this. And they coached me, and they told me what to say. They said, now say shandalahaya. Now say astalashandai. Now say shustalahandai. And I'd say, astalashandai, astalahandai, handalwa. And I'd do what they said. And they told me I got the Holy Spirit. And I said, okay, if you say so. And what did I do? I did absolutely nothing. I got absolutely nothing. It wasn't of God. Because it's not what tongues are. Tongues are a literal spoken language. And I was just speaking into the air. Verse 10, there are, it may be, so many kinds of voices in the world, and none of them without significance. 11, therefore, if I know not the meaning of the voice, I shall be unto him that speaketh a barbarian, and he that speaketh shall be a barbarian unto me. And that's what a lot of these churches today are. They're barbaric. They're sitting around talking into the air and saying nothing. And you ask them, what are you doing? Oh, well, I'm talking to God, and he understands what I'm saying. They don't even know what they're saying. It doesn't edify anyone. It doesn't help anyone. It's not the rules of tongues in this chapter. Verse 12, even so ye, for as much as ye are zealous of spiritual gifts, seek that ye may excel to the edifying of the church. It's all about edifying. Edifying is to lift them up, to comfort, to teach, to instruct. You go to church to learn. You don't go to church to feel good. A lot of people tell me, well, I just love speaking tongues because it makes me feel good. Well, if it was all about feeling good, then let's all go get drunk and fornicate. I don't think so. Uh-uh. That's not what it's about. Nowhere in the Bible does it say it's all about feeling good. Matter of fact, when you go to church, often you don't feel good because the preacher preaches so hard on sin, it makes you feel bad because you know you're guilty. And that's the way it ought to be. So verse 12, excel to the edifying of the church. Verse 13, wherefore let him that speaketh in an unknown tongue pray that he may interpret. So if a man speaks in an unknown tongue, which is unknown to the church, then he needs to interpret that. So if I get in a church and all speak English and I'm speaking in Spanish, then I need to say, okay, now I'm going to interpret that. Or I need to pray that God will send someone along. Let's say that I go to an English-speaking church, I speak Spanish, and no one there speaks Spanish, except this German guy, and he speaks German and Spanish. So I preach in Spanish, and the German guy translates from Spanish to English. Well, as you read the chapter, you know, that might sound far-fetched, but that's what it's saying in verse 27. If any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two, or at the most by three, and that by course, and let one interpret. So a guy can, there can be two or three. One preaching in one language, another guy interprets that, and then the last guy interprets it in the language of the entire church to where everyone understands. That's what this chapter's talking about. So verse 14, for if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful. What is it then? I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing in the spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also. I've talked to so many people that when they speak in an unknown tongue in the church, in the Pentecostal movement, they say, I don't know. It's a heavenly language. Only God and the spirit understands. And yet Paul says, no. You're going to preach and you're going to pray in a tongue, it's with your own understanding. You need to understand what you're saying. How do you know you're not cursing God? You ever thought of that? You don't know because you don't know what you're saying because you're not following the scriptures in the teachings of tongues. Verse 15, what is it then? I will pray with the Spirit and I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit and I will sing with the understanding also. Paul says it's important to understand because that is edifying to others. 16, else when thou shalt bless with the Spirit, how shall he be occupied He that occupieth the room of the unlearned say, Amen, at the giving of thanks, seeing he understandeth not what thou sayest. So Paul is talking about praying, and he says he's praying out loud in the church. And so when he prays out loud in the church, he's praying in a language so they know what he's praying and they can hear him praying. So that when he's done praying, people can say, Amen. Because that Amen means, I agree. And people say, yeah, I agree with what you're praying. How can they agree if nobody knows what you're saying? 17, for thou variously give thanks well, but the other is not edified. It all is so important, edifying. That's what church is for. 18, I thank God, my God, I speak with tongues more than you all. He spoke Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. He might have spoken Arabic as well. Aramaic as well. Now watch this, verse 19. Yet in the church I had rather speak five words with my understanding, that by my voice I may teach others also, than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. So this edifying means to teach. And Paul said that tongues that are spoken, it's to prophesy, it's preaching. And that preaching needs to teach others. So tongues are to edify. What does that mean? It means when you're preaching in a church, if you're preaching in a tongue, an unknown to the church, no one's edified. So you've got to preach in the same language that the church speaks, or find someone that can translate your language into the language the church speaks so that the church can be edified. That's what this chapter is saying. Paul said, I'd rather speak five words with my understanding than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. But your modern Pentecostal charismatic would say the exact opposite. They say when they speak in tongues, they don't know what they're saying. Well, they're against Paul yet again. Verse 20, brethren, be ye not children in understanding, howbeit in malice be ye children, but in understanding be men. He's saying, grow up. In the law it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips will I speak unto this people, and yet for all that will they will not hear me, saith the Lord. Okay, that's a quote of Isaiah 28:11. It says, wherefore tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, now watch this, but to them that believe not. But prophesying serveth not for them that believe not, but to them that believe. Do you understand what that just said? Tongues are a sign for unbelievers. So you claim to be a Christian, why are you speaking in tongues? Are you an unbeliever? I was. I was in the Assembly of God movement. Assembly of God's movement. I was in the Pentecostal church, and they told me speak in tongues to get the Holy Spirit. And they lied to me. They didn't even tell me the gospel. I cannot remember in 4 years in the Pentecostal church hearing the gospel one time. Never heard it. I heard a perversion of the gospel. When I heard the gospel and believed and was saved and sealed, I knew, hey, I don't need tongues. I've got salvation through Jesus Christ. So tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, but to them that believe not. Now, who needs a sign? 1 Corinthians 1:22. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 22 says, for the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. So tongues are a sign for unbelievers. And these unbelievers are Jews. So like I told you from the beginning, that miracle of tongues that God did was Jews for Jews. And as the church changed from Jews to Gentiles, no longer was that tongues important. Paul says that's not important. What's more important is edifying. What's more important is prophesying, preaching. So why do you want to speak in tongues? Why do you want to have those gifts the apostles had? Theoretically today, there could be the gift of tongues. You could be on a desert island, just you and a Jew. And that Jew only speaks Hebrew, and you only speak English. And theoretically speaking, because the signs are for the Jews, you could pray and ask God, help me, God, to witness to this man. And it just might happen that you begin preaching the gospel, and he understands in his own language everything you're saying. I've heard a story of that happening in Lebanon, where an English man spoke to a Lebanese woman, who I guess had some Jewish blood, who didn't speak any English. But she understood every word of the gospel that this man preached to her. And I'm not going to go into that, but tongues are for a sign, and the sign is for the Jews. So that's the only way that it really can work today, according to the Scriptures. So verse 22 in 1 Corinthians 14, wherefore tongues are for a sign, not to them that believe, but to them that believe not. But prophesying serveth not for them that believe not, but for them that believe. Okay, so if you are saved, if you're a Christian, if you're a believer, quit the tongues and speak in a language that people can understand. For goodness sake, don't go to your Pentecostal church and go, blah, 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 just sit down, shut up, sit on the pew and say, preacher, give me doctrine. Give me something good. What did Paul say in verse 6? I shall speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine. Where is the doctrine in the Pentecostal church? Well, it's bad doctrine because they taught me something that wasn't true. They told me I had to speak in tongues to get the Holy Spirit. And they never gave me the gospel. When I got out of that movement is when I got saved. And then I realized, hey, once I'm saved, I have received the Holy Spirit. And it's not through speaking in tongues. So verse 23, if therefore the whole church be come together into one place and all speak with tongues, and there come in those that are unlearned or unbelievers, will they not say that ye are mad? So imagine, you've got a church here, and there's one common language in the day of Paul. That's Greek. So everybody in the church should be speaking Greek. But what if everybody in the church knew another language, and each one of them talked in their own little language? Well, they divide up into little groups, just like in the Tower of Babel. And you go in the church, you got all these different groups all speaking different languages. And if someone went to the church because they wanted to learn the truth of the gospel, they'd say, this is crazy. These people don't even speak the same thing. I don't even understand them. And then what will they say? Here Paul says, will they not say that you're mad? Will they not say, you guys are crazy? So it's important to preach and prophesy in a language that's not unknown, in a language that all people understand. Verse 24, but if all prophesy and there come in one that believeth not, or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, he is judged of all. Verse 25, and thus are the secrets of his heart made manifest, and so falling down on his face, he will worship God and report that God is in you of a truth. So here it's talking about preaching. Bible preaching brings conviction. This is from Bible preaching. If a man hears the preaching of the Bible in his own tongue, it can convict him. But most of your Pentecostal churches, they don't care about the Bible teaching. Like I said, 5, 10, 15, 20 minute message, and the rest of the service is devoted to coming down the aisle and just saying, blah, 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 blah. It's not what the church was instituted for. Now, let's look at some more of the rules. Verse 26, how is it then, brethren, when you come together, every one of you hath a psalm, hath a doctrine, hath a tongue, hath a revelation, hath an interpretation? Paul says, let all things be done unto edifying. So, does that church edify? If any man speak, now notice that it says man. We're going to look at in a minute a verse that says no women are allowed to speak in the church in tongues or in the sense of prophesying or preaching. So why is the Pentecostal church full of women speaking in tongues? Why are there women pastors when in the Bible there's no such thing? It says, in verse 26, how is it then, brethren? Oh, I just read that one. Verse 27, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two, or at the most by three, and that by course, and let one interpret. All right, so if you're in a church, and someone wants to speak in tongues, the rule is that it be by two, or at the most by three, and they have to go by course. That means one at a time. And there must be an interpreter. Do you know how many Pentecostal churches I was in before I was saved? And when they all go down at the altar and they all are speaking in tongues, there's 5, 10 people over here, 20 people here, 13 back there, a couple back in their pews, and they're all saying, blah, 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 and they're all talking. What are they doing? They're disobeying the scripture that says, let it be at one or by two or at the most by three and that by course. Why does God say not to let them all talk at once? Because it's supposed to be for edifying, and that edifies no one when a bunch of people are talking at the same time. I was in a Pentecostal church one time, and I had gotten out of the Pentecostal church, I got saved, and I was in Bible school. And in Bible school, I took 3 years of Greek. Oh, I hate Greek. And 1 year of Hebrew. And so I went back in between Bible school, I think it was around Christmas holiday, to visit some family. And my family said, I want you to go with me to where I go to church. And I said, where do you go to church? They said, Pentecostal. And I said, oh boy. Well, unfortunately, I had flown to visit my family, and I didn't have a car of my own. So I had to go where they were going. And they said, well, I'm going to church. You can sit in the car if you want to. Oh, instead of sitting in the car on that cold day, I went inside and sat down in the very back of the church, and I was studying for my Greek test, which was in a week or two. And so I had my book of Greek right here, and I was reading in Greek. And they all went down and did their little thing. Like I said, 10, 15, 20-minute sermon. And then for an hour and a half, they all sat out there, blah, 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 until some of them passed out or whatever. And I was sitting in the back just going, I hope this is over soon because I want to go home. I'm tired. I've been flying in the airplane all day. And I was sitting in the back minding my own business. And this man, I'll never forget it, this man said, brother. He came up and said, brother, you're really missing out. He said, look at this. God is moving and His Spirit is everywhere. And I looked at him. I said, look, I don't want to burst your bubble. I said, that's great what all they're doing and everything. I said, but I am so spiritual that I don't need to speak in tongues anymore. And he said, what? I said, watch this. And I showed him my Greek New Testament. I said, I read tongues. And I'll never forget it. This guy looked at me and goes, amen, brother, hallelujah. And he walked away. And I just sat there going, I wasn't edifying anybody. Nobody was edifying me. That wouldn't edify him. He can't read it. We were wasting our time and God's time sitting in that place. I'll tell you another story. One time after I'd gotten saved and moved away from home, got into a good Bible-believing church, I went back and visited some family. And there were some of my friends that still weren't saved. They were still going to those Pentecostal churches. And I went back and visited them and went to one of their services. And I sat there and they had an evangelist. And the evangelist, he was going around and he's saying, hallelujah, bless God. Oh, I feel the Spirit of God. And then he went, somebody in this congregation has got a demon. Oh, and he started walking toward me. I said, all right, Lord, here we go. Because I believe that guy probably had one because he was preaching false doctrine. And then I saw him stop and he touched a man on the head. And he said, oh, be out, demon. Boom, and he hit that guy. And that guy's head hit the pew so hard, the guy literally passed out. He was knocked out. And he's laying there. And people were like applauding, amen, brother, amen. And I was sitting there going, this is nuts. Why did I come here again? And then that preacher, that evangelist, he said, oh, I feel the Spirit of God one more time. There's another demon. And he started walking toward me. And I was looking at him. And I looked right in his eyes. And he got about, 2 feet away from me. He says, I found out there's a demon. And he started putting his hand right toward me. And I said, I'm saved by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And I know I'm going to heaven when I die. And he said, this guy right here has a demon. It was just like that. It was like the demon inside that guy went, blah, 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 oh, and he went to somebody else. You see, there's some shallow preaching out there. And those Assembly of God churches, many of them don't know the Bible. And they want so much to be spiritual and have the spiritual gifts, but they don't even follow the preaching and the teaching of the Word of God. So, what does it say? Well, let's go back to verse 27. If any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be. And I don't know if that guy had a demon, but I know one thing. I know I don't. I know I'm saved and on my way to heaven. I'm not about to let some guy hit his hand on me and hit me back so hard that I pass out. I'm going to stand up to him. Yeah, I'm saved by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. I trust the blood to save my soul. And it was like, he just, there was something in that guy. That's all I'm saying. That was weird. And let it be the two, or at the most by three, and that by chorus, and let one interpret. Now, verse 28. But if there be no interpreter, let him keep silence in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. Did you get that? If you are in a Pentecostal church or a charismatic church, and there's more than two or three people speaking, then you need to get up and walk out because they have just obeyed the Word of God. And if they get up there and speak and no one is interpreting what they're saying, you need to get up and walk out. They're disobeying the rules that God set up for speaking in tongues in a church. And it says, if there's no interpreter, be quiet. Sit down and shut up and speak to yourself and God. Now, verse 29 says, let the prophet speak two or three and let the other judge. Okay? Well, we just saw that before, if they speak, it'd be two or three at the most and by course. So you should never have two or three men speaking at the same time in a church. What does that mean? That means there's a preacher, someone is preaching. He preaches. If the church doesn't understand, then someone interprets his language into their language so they will understand. and then another guy starts, and then another guy starts. No, never should you ever be in a church service when more than two or three men are speaking at one time. That's against the rules of the Bible. In verse 30, if anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. All right, so if somebody's speaking, you don't interrupt them. You hold your peace. That's what the Bible says. In verse 31, for you may all prophesy one by one, that you may learn and all be comforted. So in the Bible, there are pastors. But in the Bible, not just the pastor preaches. In the Bible, in the church, there were other men in the church that preached. What bothers me so much, and I've seen this so much, is pastors take over a church and they're the only ones that speak, and they never want another man in the church to stand up and say anything. I've been to churches where there's four or five preachers, and they all tell me, man, I'm just tired of sitting here. I want to be used of God. I have some things that can be great for this church if they just let me preach. In the Bible, it talks about elders. In the church, there's more than just one man who's the head of everything. There's three or four or five. So it's a shame to see churches where a pastor is a dictator and only he allows people himself to speak and never lets anybody else. It's good to hear from others. It's edifying. They can edify you. And that's a good way to train them so that they can go out and be pastors. Well, verse 31, for ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. Now we're getting close to the end here. Verse 33, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. So if you're in an Assembly of God church and there is confusion, then that's not of God. Now, there was a guy that made a video years ago about the Brownsville Revival, and he claimed to be a Pentecostal. And I can't remember his name, but he made this great video and he showed that movement. Hank Hanegraaff wrote a book, Christianity in Crisis, and he showed that movement called the Assembly of God Church, which was the Brownsville Revival. And it's interesting because Hank Hanegraaff spoke against that revival and said they're not following the Bible. And Mr. Kilpatrick, I think his name was, no, Kilpatrick, the pastor of that church over there, said God's going to strike down this Hank Hanegraaff in 90 days. And as soon as he said that, people said, okay, let's mark it down on our calendar, 90 days. And so 90 days later, everyone was expecting something to happen to Hank Hanegraaff, who preached against what's happening at this Brownsville Revival. And on the 90th day, Mr. Kilpatrick, the pastor of the Brownsville Revival, fell off the roof of his house and went to the hospital. Now the Bible says the spirit of the prophets, listen to that, are subject to the prophets. So this Mr. Kilpatrick, the head of the Assembly of God Church where the so-called Brownsville Revival started, prophesied in 90 days God's going to get that guy, Hank Hanegraaff, and in 90 days God got him instead. So, you know, do you think that's of God? That so-called revival should have stopped right there. Now, I've driven by that church when they had the revival in the 1990s, and it was sad. People were dressed like sluts standing in line outside to get into that church. There's actually a ministry in that church and in many Assembly of God and Pentecostal churches. You know what the ministry is? A woman walks around with handkerchiefs that are about this big. And when they're speaking in tongues, they'll pass out on the floor. And women with short skirts will be passed out with their legs out. And this woman, her ministry is to go around with the handkerchiefs and put it over her short miniskirt so no man can look up her skirt. Now, you want to tell me that's of God? That's sick! You don't go to church to lay down on the floor and spread your legs so people can look up your skirt. A ministry of, oh, I carry the little napkin so I can put that over so no one can see that. That's wrong. How does that edify? That might edify a little 8 or 9 year old kid to learn anatomy, but that doesn't edify anybody else. Here we get to it. Are you ready? Verse 33, for God is not the author of confusion, but of peace as in all churches of the saints. Now here it is, verse 34. This right here divides the men from the boys. This right here shows whether you're a Bible believer or a wicked, ungodly reprobate who wants to disobey God. Because the Assembly of God Church is nothing but women that stand up and speak in church. And what does verse 34 say? Let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. Verse 35, and if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for a woman to speak in the church. Now that doesn't mean that a woman can't at church go up to another woman and say, hey sister, how you doing? That doesn't mean that before you're preaching, a woman can't go and say, hey brother, how are you? And say, well, guess what happened this week, and talk. The context is prophesying, which is preaching. And the context is tongues. So preaching in another language. So this verse is saying that no women are allowed to preach in the pulpit in a church. So any woman who claims to be a woman preacher, she has just disobeyed the Word of God. Let's go to 1 Timothy. And you go to those Pentecostal charismatic churches, they're full of women. I've known men in this world that weren't saved, that weren't Christians. You know what they told me? They said the best women and the easiest women to get with are the Pentecostal women. They said, find a good Pentecostal woman and you can get her in bed anytime you want. I don't know why that's true, but that's been true for many people. They're floozies, many of them. They're disobedient to God, so because they're disobedient to God, it's easy to get them to do whatever you want them to do. Now, I said 1 Timothy. I believe that's what I want, 1 Timothy. There's a verse here that talks about why women should not be, 1 Timothy chapter 2, should not be pastors. There's no such thing as a woman pastor or deacon in the Bible. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, and verse 11 and on, it says, let the women learn in silence with all subjection. Well, that's what we just read in 1 Corinthians. It's not permitted unto them to speak. They are to be under obedience, as also saith the law. It's a shame for a woman to speak in the church. Well, here in 1 Timothy 2, 11, let the women learn in silence with all subjection. 12, but I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. Now, why? Is Paul just a sexist bigot? That's what they call him today. That's what the feminazis would say. Paul, you sexist bigot! You just hate women! No, because Paul is writing through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, so it's God that wrote this. So do you want to obey God? Yeah. Verse 13, for Adam was first formed, then Eve. And Adam was not being deceived, but the woman being deceived was in the transgression. So who is the easier one to deceive? The woman. And God says the woman is to be silent in the churches because a woman is more easily deceived. And all of your charismatic women in the Pentecostal churches, they're deceived because they're all doing the preaching. They're all doing the speaking. They're all the ones in the church going, and there's hundreds of them all at the same time. And God says, no, men only, at the most two or three and by course. And let the women keep silence in the churches. Because that speaking in tongues is in the context of preaching in the church, done by men for edifying. And Paul said, I suffer not a woman to teach, nor to usurp authority over a man. So if you call yourself an assembly of God, if you call yourself a Pentecostal or a charismatic, what are you doing? You go to your church and you stand up and you speak in tongues, and you're a woman? You must not love God. Because you're not following the scripture or the rules that Paul set up in the Bible. Let me show you one more thing. Go to 1 Timothy again. You see, when there's a pastor or a deacon, it has to be a man. It can't be a woman. In 1 Timothy chapter 3, it says, this is a true saying, if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. Well, a bishop is a pastor. If a man, it doesn't say a woman. Verse 2, a bishop must then be blameless, the husband of one wife. Vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to preach. So, it says that he has to be the husband of one wife. How's that work? You see, a woman is not supposed to be a preacher or a teacher, according to the Word of God. Because she's not allowed to prophesy in the church. And she's not supposed to teach. Now, that doesn't mean a woman can't walk out on the street with her Bible and find somebody walking down the road and say, hey, can I tell you how to get saved? That's wonderful. That she should do that, tell people how to be saved. But in the pulpit, in the ministry, in the pastorate, God gives no place for a woman. In Titus Titus chapter 1. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, that the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, and charity, and patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. So a woman may teach, but a woman is only supposed to teach other women, not a man. And Paul said, I suffer not a woman to teach or usurp authority over a man. God did not call women to be preachers. God called men. One more verse, Titus chapter 1 and verse 6. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly, for a bishop must be blameless. So it's talking about a man who has a wife. And that's who a bishop or a pastor should be. No women pastors in the Bible. If you're a woman pastor and you're offended by this, I'm sorry, but that's what God says. And you will give account to God someday because you did not follow His rules in the Bible. You either follow God or you don't. Now I guess there's only one way that a woman could be a pastor. The Bible says to be an elder, you have to be the husband of one wife. So I guess if a woman marries another woman, then I guess biblically, scripturally, then it's okay. I don't think so. That's a whole other thing, but that's the way the world has gone, hasn't it? They've given the right to homosexuals to marry, and now women marrying women. I wonder if someday there won't be women pastors of the first homosexual Baptist church, or the first sodomite memorial Methodist chapel, or something like that. The world's in a crazy place right now. It might head that way. But if you want to be a Bible believer, you need to realize God set it up. The man is ahead of the family. The wife is under the man. And the women are not supposed to speak in churches. They're supposed to allow the men to preach. And the preaching is for doctrine and teaching and learning. 35. 1 Corinthians 15:35. And if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for a woman to speak in the church. 36. What? Came the word of God out from you? Or came it unto you only? 37, if any man think himself to be a prophet, and notice it says, if any man, no women, no women prophets, no women prophesying, no women speaking in tongues in the churches, yet the whole entire Pentecostal Assembly of God charismatic movement is women speaking in tongues in the church, out loud, unruly, full of confusion. 37, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. Now someone might be watching this that's a woman that has done all these things her whole life that I'm preaching against. Well, I want you to know you're not mad at me. You're mad at God. Because Paul said, this isn't my opinion. I'm not telling you what I think. He said, the things that I write unto you are the commandments of God. These are God's rules. You either follow them, and by so doing obey God, or you rebel against God. Are you a rebellious woman? I like 1 Timothy 5:6. 1 Timothy 5:6 is an interesting verse. It's a scary verse. 1 Timothy 5:6 says, but she that liveth in pleasure is dead while she liveth. What a rebuke to a wicked, rebellious woman. And God says, you think you're full of life and you think you love me and you go around trying to feel good all the time and live in pleasure, you're dead to me. As far as I'm concerned, you're dead while you're living because you're an unruly person who disobeys the Word of God. So if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. Are you going to acknowledge that? Do you acknowledge that what I've said to you was the Bible? You say, well, that was written a long time ago. It's changed. No. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. If this is the commandment of the Lord, then this is for us today under Paul's ministry. No women preachers. No women speaking in the church. No women speaking in tongues in a pulpit. That's just what the Bible says. You either like it or you don't. You love it or you can lump it, bump it, jump it, and drop dead. It's what God says. 38, but if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. If any woman wants to be made ignorant, help yourself. Just know you'll give account to God at the judgment someday for what you do.
If any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. Verse 39, wherefore, brethren, covet to prophesy, and forbid not to speak with tongues. All right, I'm not forbidding anyone to speak in tongues. But you got to remember, if any man be ignorant, I'm not going to forbid men to speak in tongues. But women are forbid to speak in tongues, according to the Word of God in the church. So if you're a woman and you're doing that, you have gone against, verse 37, the commandments of the Lord. But what is more important? Prophesying. Prophesying is preaching. The most important thing in the church service is preaching the Bible. Why? So people can learn doctrine. And when you learn, oops, I'll fill it right here in a minute, then you can live it. If you learn it, live it. And that's what Pentecostals don't want to do. They don't want to learn it. I've talked to many Pentecostal women and went through this chapter with them, and they say, I don't want to hear that. I just love my church, and I just love going and doing it. It makes me feel good. So you want to disobey God and do something wrong. Something that the Kundalini movement does to get a demonic spirit. So when you disregard God's laws and go against His rules and do things that God said not to do, how do you know you don't have a demon? Better be careful. Forbid not to speak with tongues. Yeah, any man who's a preacher can preach in tongues as long as someone interprets. That's what the rules say. So if you, let's say you came to America from Mexico. Your first language is Spanish. And you don't speak English as well as Spanish. But you feel God's called you to be a preacher. And a pastor invites you to your church and says, hey, come preach for me. And you say, well, pastor, I speak better in Spanish than English. Well, then the pastor says, well, that's okay. We got a guy here that can translate. I'm not going to forbid that. The pastor shouldn't forbid that. Let him preach in Spanish in that church as much as he wants, as long as there's an interpreter. And as long as, the last verse, as long as all things be done decently and in order. Verse 40. Let all things be done decently and in order. There's a lot of disorder in Pentecostal charismatic churches. There's a lot of disorder in the Assembly of God church. When they all go down and they all start doing this, many of them pass out. Many of them lay on the floor. If you look at that Brownsville revival, many of them start shaking like this, which is pretty much a sign of demonic possession. Many of them are on the floor and they start to cluck like a chicken. Many of them bark like a dog. And you want to tell me that's of God? That's the Spirit of God making you look like a fool? Let all things be done decently and in order. Is that decent? Is it decent for a woman to pass out and open her legs so people can see up her skirt? And someone has to run real quick and cover her up with a napkin? Is that decent and in order? Really? Really? You want to tell me you're of God? No, I've got the rules. I just read them to you. I'm no longer a part of the Assembly of God Church, nor do I ever, ever want to be. Now, I have some friends that still go to that. I wish they'd get out. All I can do is preach to them. If you get out, that's wonderful. Because the Bible is so great. If you just follow it. So that's what the Bible says about tongues. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Tongues are for a sign, verse 22, not to them that believe, but to them that are unbelievers. And 1 Corinthians 1:22, the signs are for the Jews. So we don't even need tongues today. It's not a gift that we need to practice. If you only speak English and you never learn any other language, great. There's no big deal. You haven't lost anything. Long as you know you're saved. The moment you believe, Ephesians 1:13, you're sealed. You receive the Holy Spirit and you're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. You do not have to speak in tongues to receive the Holy Spirit. That's not what the chapter said. Nowhere does it say in 1 Corinthians 15 that the Spirit of God comes through speaking in tongues. That's a perversion of the Scriptures. So I appreciate you watching this. I hope I had charity, chapter 13. I tried to. But also, it's just sad to see people deceived. And who is so easily deceived? Women. That's why the majority of Pentecostal churches are women. Most of them married 3, 4, 5 times. Because they've been deceived into following an anti-biblical, man-made religious system rather than the Bible. A system that started in Azusa Street with what? Do you remember? What started the Pentecostal movement, the Assembly of God movement? A woman preacher coming to preach a revival on Azusa Street Mission. So it all started in disobedience to the Word of God. Let me read verse 34 and 35 again. Let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. And if they will learn anything, let them ask their husband at home, for it is a shame for a woman to speak, which is preached from the pulpit in the church. So that's 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I hope it's been a blessing. I hope you've learned something. If you are a Christian, I hope you'll share this with others. I hope this has helped you become a Christian. Remember, I was in the Assembly of God movement. I wasn't saved. Never heard the gospel. So if maybe you're a Pentecostal and you're watching this, come to the truth. Come to the gospel. Make sure you're saved. Paul says in another passage, examine yourselves to see if you're even saved. Do you know that you have the Holy Spirit? Do you know you're going to heaven when you die? That's what's so important. Well, next time is chapter 15, the gospel. And that's what it's all about, is being saved by the gospel. So next time, we'll pick up there in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I appreciate you being with us, and God bless you, and I look forward to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse by verse, next time. Thank you.